going to ask everyone to begin to assemble yourselves. Sister Jones, you can have remarks at this time at the mic to my left, to your right, Prophetess Billy as well. The family is going to make space for you all to give brief remarks prior to the service getting started. Please come. Everyone give your full attention. Ushers, let no one else come down the center aisle. Also, I'm asking that you would please turn your phones on vibrate or silent so that we won't have any interruptions. She's going to give remarks. Parks. This is Mitchell's older sister. Amen. Give her a hand as she comes.
I'm going to sing a little something for you that I wrote, believing that Carlene would want to say to you all. To all my family and friends, I say, I love you. Beside God, you're the center of my life. And my daughter, she's so beautiful and kind. And my son, so much like me, so glad you're mine. And my husband, he's the better half of me. And in my world, he's every woman's dream. Lord, I say to you, thank you for all you've done for me. Lord, I say to you, thank you for all you've done for me. Thank you.
Is Prophetess Billy in the room? Please come. While she's coming, I'm going to call the following people that are going to have remarks in this service on today, and I'm going to ask you to come and to join us on the pulpit. Since we will be streaming this service, we want to expedite you coming to the mic and not have to negotiate the steps. I'm looking for Sister Barbara Ray Bickers, Colette Selma. Pastor Kelly Lane is already on the rostrum. Deborah Johnson, Pastor Linda Harper. If those individuals are in the room, you should come to the pulpit. You can be seated with us. I'm also going to ask my sister, Tasha Page Lockhart, if she is in the room, I'm going to ask her to come to the pulpit where the musicians are, if she's not already there. Thank you. After these remarks, we'll begin the homegoing celebration.
Praise the Lord, everyone.
Praise the Lord.
Trying to make this as quick as possible, but William and Ida Lindsay had 7 children, and I'm the oldest, and Carlene is the baby. And I thank God that I've had a child on my hip since I was 10 years old. And my brother Calvin and my sister Lonnie came just before Carlene. And so my mother was really busy with sewing and cooking and cleaning, but those two were like my babies. So I bathed them, I fed them, I took care of them. And so I was saying, now I'm getting into teenage, so now I can get a break and I can start living life as a teenager, running, jumping, going to the playground with my girlfriends and stuff. But one day my mother was rubbing some mother's friend up her stomach. Some of you know about that mother's friend. That's what the pregnant women would use on their stomachs to keep it smooth, to keep from stomach cracking from the stretch marks. And I said, Mama, you pregnant again? And she just laughed, you know. And I was really upset because I'm getting ready to have some fun without a baby. I said, I don't want another baby. But needless to say, she had a beautiful baby girl, Carlene Frances Miss. Even though I complained, I took care of her just like I did the other two. And of course, I adored my brothers. But I noticed that with my other siblings, when they would do something, I would just stand my hand. You know, like whatever, or get on them, or whoop them, or whatever I had to do. But with Carlene, when she would do something, it was just biting my spirit. And I said, Lord, this is not right, because I don't want my sister hurt. But it's hard for me to be around her. So I sought the Lord, and I learned about deliverance and inner healing. And I laid on my face before the Lord. And I said, Holy Spirit, deliver me. And while I was lying there, I began to call out resentment, rejection, bitter root judgment. I forgave my mother and I forgave my sister. They didn't do anything, but she, my mother multiplied and my sister was born. But I perceived and I took it personal. And I just want to say that God delivered me. I got up off that floor, I found my sister, and I don't think there's any other sisters closer than me and my sisters. The bond was there. I did not allow the enemy to kill, steal, and destroy beautiful times I could have with my sister. So I don't have to stand here with guilt, shame, and embarrassment and remorse, because we had beautiful moments and the enemy was trying to steal it, but he wasn't able to do it. I fought for our relationship. Why am I saying this? Because some of you out here need to take care of that. You need to get before God and forgive some people and release them from the spirit of unforgiveness and ask God to help. I'm not the speaker, but if you want prayer, I'll help you. Because I thank God for the wonderful times and memories I had with my sister in spite of what the enemy was trying to do. So I want to say to my brother-in-law, Mitchell, thank you for loving my sister. They loved and adored one another. I thought Mitch loved her with all his heart and there wasn't any more room, but he proved to me over the years that he kept making more and more room to love my sister and to protect her and to be there for her. And I want to say to my niece and nephew, I love you. This is Auntie. Call me anytime. Thank you for the time.
Let's just say amen. At this time, I will again ask you to make sure that you have your phones on silent or vibrate. And for those of you that have family members and friends that would like to be here but could not be here because of whatever reasons, they can stream this service beginning immediately on Rochelle V, as in Victory, Man's Facebook and YouTube. Rochelle V, Man's, that's two N's, M-A-N-N-S, Facebook and YouTube. You can text that out to individuals that wanted to be here but could not be here for whatever reasons. I am Bishop Charles H. Ellis III, Senior Pastor here at Greater Grace Temple, City of David. We welcome all of you all here on today. First Lady is here. Stand, please. Lady Chrisette. give God praise for her. It is our honor to serve our brother, one that we've known practically most all of our teenage years up to this day. 37 years ago, Mitchell was a son of this house and is always a son of this house. And Mitchell had a lot of folk running after him. And then there was one that walked by and he started doing the running. And once he caught her, 37 years later, the rest is history. Mitch and Carlene have been tied at the hip. If you see one, you see the other. Stand and give God praise for this couple. 37 years of marital bliss. It's hard to find in this day and time, but it is still possible. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Mitchell and the family have outlined the order of service that we will follow. This time, Sister Bobby Storm will come with a musical selection. After she has concluded, we will have the scripture readings, Old Testament, Pastor Parks Stewart, New Testament, Pastor Carl Reed, and then we will have our prayer and invocation by Pastor Linda Harper. After she has concluded, then we will have the Dunamis Outreach Ministries praise team. Let's receive all of these in this order.
Bye. And give him glory. It's all right.
Well.
As they play softly the Old Testament scripture, we honor the Lord today to Bishop Ellis, the clergy, to everyone, because everyone is somebody in God. My dear friend Mitchell, to Lindsay family, to their family is my family. I'll reserve my words for a later time. Isaiah chapter number 25, verse number 6. And in this mountain shall the Lord of hosts make unto all the people a feast of fat things, a feast of wines on the lees, of fat things full of marrow, a wine on lees, well refined. And he will destroy in this mountain the face of the covering cast all over the people, and the veil that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death in victory. And the Lord God will wipe away tears from all our faces. And the rebuke of his people shall he take away from all the earth, for the Lord has spoken it.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Our New Testament reading is taken from 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse number 51. The scripture reads, it says, "Behold, I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we will all be changed in a moment and in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trump will sound, and the dead in Christ shall rise and be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. For this imperishable must put on imperishable, and this mortal must put on immortality. But when this perishable will have put on imperishable, and this mortal will have put on immortality. Then will the end come about this saying that is written. O death, where is your victory? Death, where is your sting? For the sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be unto God. I said, thanks be unto God, who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, beloved brethren, steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that your toil is not in vain in the Lord. Following instructions, my dear brother Mitchell, he is the ebony, I am the ivory. I met Mitchell Jones in high school, and we were together, and we hung together, and I'm still with Mitchell. I'm going to miss our early morning talks. He and I would talk about the Bible, talk about the Word. And I'm going to miss when Carlene and Toy in the background will come and take over the conversation. And Mitch and I had to sit by idly until they had finished. I'm going to miss her beautiful smile. I'm going to miss her quick wit. I'm going to miss the times that we spent together every Sunday after service, going to our favorite restaurant, the French Toast. I thank God for Carlene Lindsay-Jones. She was a beautiful lady. Classy. Never could find anything to say. Not that I was searching. But I loved her. I love Mitchell. I love their children. I love their grandchildren. I'm jealous because I don't have any grandchildren. I'm jealous. But Mitchell, I got you. I'm there for you, brother. We're going to be together. My travel dog, my wife and Toy and Carlene traveled together, shopped together. She was Toy's road dog. We're going to miss her. But this one thing I say to you, we're going to see her again. We're going to love on her again. And it's going to be howdy, howdy, and never goodbye. I love you, brother, and I got you.
Good morning. God bless you. Midge man, you know I love you. That's my brother. BJ, I know you don't like me to call you BJ, but BJ. Adrian. Prophetess. It is an honor to go before the Father at this time. So let us pray. Holy Father God, in the matchless name of your precious Son Jesus, we your people come. We come with the recognition, Lord God, that at all times, in every moment, no matter what the circumstance, you are good and your mercy endures forever. So we thank you, Lord God, that you love us enough, Lord God, to fill this place with your manifest presence. We know you're with us always, God, but sometimes we need to just feel your presence. So God, in the name of Jesus, we, your people, come together invoking the name of your precious Son, Father, asking that you would just touch us in a special way on this morning. We thank you that you loved us enough to give us the gift of Carlene Francis Lindsay-Jones. God, you must have loved us, Lord God, to bless the earth with such a beautiful creation. And oh God, in that vein, Lord God, recognizing that everything that you do is good, for you are light and in you there is no darkness at all. And even in the inexplicable moments, Lord God, you understand. And we thank you, Lord God, that you give a peace, Lord God, that passes our understanding, oh God. We thank you, Lord God, that she was born again and she was implanted with that incorruptible seed, Lord God, so that the corruptible is now incorruptible, Lord God. We thank you for the gift of eternal life. We thank you that you play the long game, Father. We thank you, Lord God, that you are the God of all comfort and consolation. We thank you, Lord God, that you are the God of all wisdom, Lord God, and all might, Lord God. We thank you, Lord God, that in any moment, at any time, Lord God, you are still the God that does the impossible. You are still the God, Lord God, that performs miracles. You are still a promise keeper. You are still the watcher of our souls, oh God. God, we thank you, Lord God, that you love this family, that you love this man of God, that you love these children, and that you can be in them what none of us could ever be. So God, we're trusting you and we're believing you that you're going to take this thing and that you're going to make something beautiful out of it, because that's the promise, oh God. So we honor you as we honor her, and we thank you, Lord God, for loving us enough, Lord God, hallelujah, that we can stand before you in this moment, Lord God, and say we had a warrior queen that walked among us, oh God. And we thank you right now, Lord God, that she is in your presence, Lord God. And we thank you right now, Lord God, that we shall indeed see in the end if we know Jesus. Because God, that's the promise. And you never lie, Lord God. You never fail, Lord God. You are perfect in all of your ways. That's what we decree. That's what we declare on this morning, Lord God. That you are God and you always will be God. That you are a mender of the tattered soul. That's who you are, God. Jesus, we give you glory, because all these things are possible because you shed your blood for us. The life that we live is the life that you give us. And we thank you. We thank you in this moment. And we praise you. And we honor you. And we adore you even in this moment, oh God. I thank you for your healing. Thank you for your healing. Thank you for your healing, Lord God, of every wounded heart. Thank you for your strength and your might, but your soothing and your comfort in this moment. Gentle Jesus. Gentle Jesus, compassionate Jesus, who is touched when we are touched. You are touched because Mitchell is touched. You are touched because BJ is touched. You are touched because Adrian is touched. You are touched by their fear. So touch them now as you are touched and as your heart is with them. We give you glory. We give you glory. We give you glory. We give you glory. And we bind the work of the enemy. We bind his work. He shall not cause inordinate grief. Nobody is going to lose their mind, devil. You a liar. We give God glory. We give God the glory. And we honor you, Father. We honor you, Jesus. We honor you, Spirit of the living God. Great and wonderful you are. Indeed, perfect in all your ways. Hallelujah, Lamb of God. Hallelujah, Lamb of God. Hey, eternal God and Savior. It's in the matchless name of Jesus that we pray and we praise. Amen and amen. Thank you.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Can we just, for a moment, can you just lift your hands all over the room? We're gonna worship. We're gonna celebrate and thank God for the life of Carlene this morning. Hallelujah, God, you're worthy. Hallelujah, we thank you for the life that you've given us. Hallelujah, we bless your name. Hallelujah, thank you, Lord, for knowing her name before the world was framed. Oh God, we give you honor and glory. Hallelujah, we thank you for who you are. If you don't do anything else, God, you've done it all. You've done enough. We thank you that your arms are wrapped around this family. We thank you right now that every need is met. In Jesus' name, oh God, we thank you that they stand strong on your word this morning and that they know that you said that you will never leave and never forsake them, and you never have and you never will. Hallelujah. This family belongs to you. Mitchell, BJ, Adrian, family belongs to you, God. And we thank you, hallelujah. We're gonna worship our way through. We're gonna worship our way through. God, you're still good. And we're gonna worship our way through. God, you're still able. Hallelujah. You're still King of Kings and Lord of Lords. You're still the great I am. You're still my healer. You're still my provider and my way maker. You're my strong tower. Hallelujah. God, and it's already done. So we worship you and give you honor. We bless the bishop of this house and this congregation. We thank you for the village that surrounds this family. To our brother Mitch, we love you. The Dunamis Outreach Ministries, we are here for you. Whatever you think of, we got your back. You are our brother and we love you. We just want to minister here with you all. So Carlene's favorite song, it says, you know my name. You know my name, yeah. You know my name, yeah. You know my name, yeah. You know how you walk with me, yeah. Know how you talk with me, yeah. Know how you tell me, yeah, that I am your own. Help me say, you know my name. Yeah, you know my name, yeah. Before the world's framed, you know
my name.
Thank you, Lord, for loving me first. And oh, how you walk with me.
Oh, how you walk with me.
Oh, how you talk with me.
Oh, how you talk with me.
Oh, how you tell. Oh, my name. remember this.
Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word and just to rest upon his promise, just to know the Savior.
Spirit of the living God. Come on and give God praise for our music ministries on today. Sister Toy Lynn, daughter of this house, is coming with our acknowledgments of cards, telegrams, and condolences. And all of us have fond stories. And Carl talked about he met Mitch at Mumford High School. And everybody know there is no Ford in Detroit of education except Mumford. All the others are imitations. Henry Ford. Red Ford. Edsel Ford. There's only one Ford in Detroit community. That's Mumford. All my Mustang brothers and sisters, come on and stand there. Somebody said, can anything come out of good? Can anything out of Mumford come good or whatever? Absolutely. Amen. The Saved Commission came out of Mumford. Amen. Those half-saved came out of Henry Ford. Fred Hammond came out of Mumford. The Winans came out of Mumford. The Clark sisters came out of Mumford. Edgar Van came out of Mumford. The Claxtons, the Ellises, the Brinkleys came out of Mumford. And I'll tell you this, five of the seven of us graduated from Mumford, and Spencer, Pastor Spencer and Penny backslid and went to Cass. Took a bus all the way downtown when they could have gotten all of that right there up the street. And I went to Felice's graduation with my dad, my mom, and our family, and all of Mumford's graduation was at the Ford Auditorium. And the Ford Auditorium had that rising floor. And we were sitting there, and they were singing the class song. And the choir, the glee club, were singing the song, and the floor began to rise with the band. And I looked up, and there was Fred on the bass and Jeff Stanton on the lead guitar. And my father leaned over and said, is that Fred and Jeff playing that worldly music? I said, no, Dad, they got to do that or else they'll get kicked out of school. So I saved y'all from getting sat down. The Lord had me there as an intercessor. We had great times at Mumford. Receive Toy Lynn as she comes. After she has concluded, Tasha Page Lockhart will come with another musical selection.
Amen. Good morning. Oh, well, glory to God. So the family wishes me to express their heartfelt appreciation of your kindness and your outpouring of love toward them at this time. And so I'm just going to read a couple of cards. The ones we love are never gone from our hearts. They visit us in old stories. They meet us in our dreams. They show up in a song or maybe a familiar face. They speak to us in moments of decision, in times when we know they'd be proud. They live on in the good things we do for the world and for each other. With sympathy for your loss, Teresa Grist and Patty Page, the Bling Girl team. Time is God's gift. We all need a time to grieve. Quiet time for reflection, to sift through our memories and come to grips with what has happened. My deepest condolences, Brother Mitch and family. Sister Carlene was a beautiful person that will be greatly missed. Praying God gives you strength and peace. Love, Sister Nakia. Her life story. Carlene Frances Lindsay-Jones was ushered into the earth by God in Detroit, Michigan on January 13, 1958. To the loving care of her parents, William and Ida Lindsay. Carlene was born the last of seven children. Her mother, father, and her brother William Jr. preceded her into the presence of the Lord God. It was noted early on that she was an exceptional addition to this loving family. Even as a young child and the family baby, she was observed to be very independent and tenacious. Carlene attended Detroit Public Schools, and as she matured, she displayed a keen focus, a generous and congenial personality that was matched by competitiveness, tempered by humility. She graduated from Mumford High School in 1976. God graced Carlene with exceptional physical beauty that was reflective of her inner beauty. During the early 1980s, she parlayed her giftings into a remarkable career in the beauty and entertainment industry that spanned decades. Her extremely noteworthy accomplishments include being crowned Miss Black World Michigan, winning the Miss Michigan United title, and placing as a finalist in the Miss Michigan competition. She was featured in Jet Magazine. These experiences and opportunities gave way to a long-term modeling career. Carlene represented Austin Productions Plus, Affiliated Models Incorporated, Gale and Rice Models, and was a member of the Models Guild. During her modeling career, she was engaged by Saks Fifth Avenue, Hudson's, Nordstrom, Jacobson's, and Gantos. Carlene traveled with the modeling tour sponsored by the Al Taubman Group in Harper's Bazaar. She counted her opportunity to participate in the USO World Tour with Bob Hope to entertain military troops in Germany as one of her career highlights. In addition to these outstanding achievements, she was an industrial model who worked during the Detroit Auto Show for a number of years while continuing to practice her craft in print and advertising and television commercials. Later on, Carlene developed her prowess as a fierce fashion show coordinator, where her events were often sold out. Ever innovative with indubitable creativity and an eye for business, she branched out into the educational component of her craftsmanship. Carlene served as an instructor at the Austin Modeling School and later opened Cartelina's Charm School in the 1990s, where many were trained by her in the art of beauty enhancement and proper social etiquette. She had a big heart and concern for the emerging generations. So she also shared her knowledge of correct decorum and presentation during seminars that she conducted for the Detroit Public Schools. During the latter years of her career, she worked as a beauty consultant at Somerset's Macy's department store from 2007 until her retirement in 2020. She later became a paparazzi jewelry consultant. Carlene literally made the world a more beautiful place. In spite of her shattering accomplishments, she made it clear where her priorities were placed. She loved God above all else, and she loved her wonderful family. Carlene was led to the knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ as her Savior by her sister Billy in 1983. She received her salvation and was baptized in the Holy Ghost during an old-fashioned Tyrian service at the House of God in Detroit, Michigan. She sang gospel with her family, the Lindsay Singers, and was part of their album that was released in 1985. She and her sister Billy were granted the privilege of mutually leading their mother to the Lord. During a conversation with her mother in 1984, Carlene stated that she was getting married the following year. She didn't know who she was going to marry, but she was adamant about it taking place. God knew. Carlene met Mitchell Brian Jones at Wheels Skating Rink during a skating party in 1984. After meeting, they didn't see each other for a while, but encountered each other again in 1985. And after a whirlwind romance, they were engaged after 3 months and married within 9 months. They shared a rare love that was fueled by their mutual love for their God and King. God bless their union with two outstandingly beautiful children, Adrian Danielle and Mitchell Bryan II. She once stated that she would kill a rock for her children. They were also blessed with 6 grandchildren. Carlene was a doting grandmother who loved her grandchildren beyond the planets and back. Carlene loved traveling with Mitch, having brothers and sister dates with her siblings, fellowshipping with friends, and practicing her role as a connoisseur of good food. Carlene and Mitchell shared a love that was not an ordinary love. During their marriage of 37 years, they impacted the world for Jesus. The first prayer meeting for Dunamis Outreach Ministry, Stone, founded and pastored by Pastor Reginald M. Lane and Pastor Kelly Lane, was conducted in the home of Mitchell and Carlene Jones. Mitchell and Carlene were integral to the formation of the Dunamis Outreach Ministries, and it's legendarily noted that they gave the very first offering to the church. Carlene ministered dutifully in the house of the Lord with a specific and sharp prophetic anointing. She served the body of Christ as a one-time member of the praise team, a teacher in and out of Dome, a speaker, and a marriage counselor with an emphasis on the support and development of wives. Carlene was an adamant intercessor and a prayer warrior with a passion for holiness to the Lord. She was a confirmed elder and oversaw the flock with love and dedicated protection. As Carlene Frances Lindsay-Jones has entered into the manifested presence of the Lord, she remains absolutely loved, cherished, and remembered by her beloved husband, Mitchell Brian Jones, her daughter Adrian McMurtry, and her husband DeMarcus, her son, Mitchell Brian Jones II, Jasmine and her children, Gabrielle, Peyton, Zoe, Joshua Journey, and Gianna, and her niece daughter, Connie Hartnett. She is further loved and remembered by her brothers and sisters, Billie Jean Kyler, Cheryl Lindsay, wife of William Lindsay Jr., Emmett Howard Lindsay and Lily, Lamont Lindsay, Rosalind Lindsay and Calvin Lindsay, and Valerie. In addition, she will be fondly and lovingly remembered by her brothers and sisters in love, Danis Bennett and Angela, Craig Jones, Sherry Glicker, Donna Green, Linda Murphy, and Keith Jones and Linda. Her Dunamis Outreach Ministries is impacted by her and cherishes the many wonderful memories of her with love. Her Macy's family will always love and remember her, and an innumerable host of additional family, loved ones, friends, colleagues, and acquaintances. The world is richer because she lived. I meant to read these two letters, and so I'll do it now. Grace and peace be multiplied to you through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. to Mitchell Jones and the family of Carlene Jones. It is with great love and concern that I share this brief missive with you on behalf of the RFCI Assembly, Restoration Fellowship Church International. I am trusting that these few words of encouragement will aptly communicate our deepest sympathy extended to you in this challenging time. While there is no earthly remedy for a heart that is broken due to loss, you and I have been given the privilege to look forward to our God. Earth has no sorrow that heaven cannot heal. Mitchell, we have shared together just like brothers over the years. It is my sincere prayer for you, the children, and your entire family to know that Restoration Fellowship Church International is interceding for you. The God of all comfort is faithful and will indeed sustain you in this trying moment and see you through to a day of pleasant memories as you celebrate Carlene's life. She was a very special person indeed, suited for Mitchell Jones in a way that only God could have arranged. I'm sure that all of you will cherish the wonderful memories of her living, leading, and serving. Now it is up to the family to begin living with an eye toward eternity, seeking God in the same way Carlene so ardently modeled. Praise God for her life. I speak peace to all of you in the great name of Jesus Christ. Bishop Michael A. Brooks. And this is from Carlene's loving Macy's family. Just look at these pictures. Anybody who saw her would be amazed by her beauty. As Carlene's co-workers, we experienced so much more of just how deep that beauty ran throughout Carlene. Not just outside, but inside too. She was kind and generous and loving. Every day when we would come to work, whomever was struggling with anything would go to Carlene. If your back was hurting, she would give you a massage. If your heart was aching, she would give you a hug and pray with you for a better outcome. If you simply felt down, Carlene would cheer you up. We were truly blessed to have Carlene in our lives. To a beautiful life comes a peaceful end. Everyone's friend. To Minister Mitchell Jones and family, the Greater Life Apostolic Church family was deeply saddened upon hearing of the loss of your dear wife, Sister Carlene. Please accept our heartfelt sympathy for you and for your family during this difficult time. Our hearts were heavy when we received the news of the recent loss of your wife, and we wanted to reach out and express our condolences during such a difficult time. We pray these words bring you a measure of comfort. We, the Greater Life Apostolic Family, will be here for you now and in the days ahead. Please don't hesitate to call upon us in your time of need. Senior Pastor Gilbert Ann Allen and Co-Pastor Carla M. Allen. And so, we celebrate the life of this great lady who lived well, who was well loved as she loved us. Amen.
I will do. I want to see him. I want to see him. To behold. To behold. To let my kingdom. I want to be where you are. I got to be where you are. I want to be where you are. Yeah, 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 yeah. Got to be where you are. Can you help me say, I want to be.
Jesus, every knee's going to bow. Every tongue has got to confess. Woo! Kings and their kingdoms, they will all have to pass away. But there's something, somebody shout, there's something about that name. Come on, if you know that name saved you, that name delivered you, that name healed you, that name made ways out of no way for you, put your hands together and give God praise for his name. We used to sing a song in the old church. His name shall be praised. His name shall be praised. The name of the Lord is a mighty strong tower. His name shall be praised. Come on and give Tasha Page like her hand. Special words of remembrance. I'm going to ask all these individuals to introduce themselves as they come. And they will come in the following order, and they will leave specific and brief remarks, and that we might have time for the family to take as much time as they want with their tributes and their remarks. Is that all right? So I will call on now Sister Barbara Ray Bickers, following Deidre Johnson, following Corlette Selma Coco, following Linda Harper, following Pastor Kelly Lane. Please come at this time.
Good afternoon, everybody. Carlene was a very, very, very special person to me. And I guess you say, why is she has a crown on her head or whatever that is? It represents the sparkle that Carlene would have when she would smile, when she would engage with different people. She always had a very cheerful smile. When I first met her, it was at a pageant, actually, and I told her that she was going to win because she had an inner beauty that showed on the outside, and she was very humble and very, like, inconspicuous. Like, she would stand in the back, and you would probably not pay attention to her because she wasn't out in the front like some of those other girls. And I just noticed her because she had, like, a glow. And we became friends that day, and we've been friends ever since. And one thing I wanted to say was she and I would enjoy bike riding in that. And one time she and I and her brother, yeah, and all of us, we went out to, I think it was Palmer Woods, yeah, park. And we were riding through the, you know, through the park, all in between the bushes and everything. And like, you know, they say Carlene is very competitive, but you wouldn't know it because she was, like, very unassuming. But when we got out there, she was out there. We were out riding. And lo and behold, Calvin, Carlene's brother, I had a Schwinn Continental bike. And he said, oh, well, let me ride your bike. You mind if I ride your bike? I said, okay, you can ride. And we switched bikes. So we were riding, and all of a sudden, we ran into this big, wide puddle. And Kelvin flew off the bike, flipped over, and splashed down into the water. And when he came up, he was drenching. And he had a maple leaf attached to his forehead. We laughed so hard. One of those kind of laughs when you can't even speak, when you're trying to say something to each other and you can't even talk. We laughed so hard. I still remember that to this day. And the last time I was with her, we were in the car together, and that was about, it was actually about a month ago or so, something like that. And we were riding, and I picked her up because I wanted to spend time with her. And we rolled out to Metropolitan Beach. I think they call it St. Clair Shore or something other out there now. And we talked. We talked about that. We talked about some modeling things. And I just had a very good time with her. And I'm going to miss her dearly. And one thing I can say about her, she's going to always shine. And if any of you went to Mitchell and Carlene's wedding, if you remember, when they came down the aisle, all the lights went down. and a big spotlight pow came on her. And as she came down, I always remember that. And right now I want to say she's going to glow. She's always going to glow because ordinary just won't do. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Shepherd of this house, Bishop Ellis. My beautiful pastor, and she really doesn't like for people to say that, but I have to because it's true. Pastor Kelly Lane, and my home church family, Dunamis Outreach Ministries. I'd like to start off just to say that to my brother and children that I absolutely love you. And you know that I absolutely loved Carlene. She was my sister, my friend, my business partner, my spiritual advisor, my keeper. And I sure needed that because I'm the one that, you know, kind of slip off sometimes. And it was good that God appointed brothers keepers, because I totally needed that. I have a couple of stories. I just want to start by saying that being a professional model is no easy task, and not everyone can do that. In the industry that we worked in, there were very few Black young women that were successful in this industry. It was hard for us for several reasons. Number one, you know, we was kind of thick, and you had to be razor thin at that time. And that's exactly why I quit, because I was very hungry and I just couldn't take it no more. I just couldn't take it no more. But Carlene, she stuck in there and she ate that little food that they, you know, they give us. They try to feed us at these shows. Am I lying, Michelle? I am not. We used to have the Black girls, not just the Black girls, had to take the bread off and just eat the meat and the lettuce, or sometimes just the lettuce. Carlene and I were the darlings of Austin's modeling school. We excelled from graduating as students to instructors, to administrative director, to the director of the school. Okay, so Austin's Modeling School owned the Miss Teen Michigan pageant and the Miss Michigan pageant at the time. 1 month in, I entered the Miss Teen Michigan pageant. I remember it's hard for us to break into this business, and especially if you're Black. Now, I'm not a militant. I'm just gonna tell the truth. It was hard for us, and there were very few of us. Am I right? Michelle, Shelley, you know. There were very few of us. So I entered the Miss Teen Michigan pageant. I finished first runner-up. Y'all know I should have won, right? But it was because I was Black. Okay. So now I think I'm big and bad, so I move on up into the Miss Michigan pageant. Mm-hmm. That's where Carlene was. This wasn't because I was Black this time. It was just because she was just so beautiful. I got out on the first round. I was mad. I went down. I sat with my mom. I said, you know, I just got out because I was Black. But Carlene went on to finish in the top, and she deserved to win. But you know why? It's because she was Black. Okay, so now we journey on to, I walked into Dunamis Outreach Ministries just to visit. But as I walked down that long hall, I saw my pastor come out of his study. I heard the praise team. When I walked in the sanctuary, I saw my sister and I knew that I was home. Dunamis Outreach Ministries became my home, and to this date, and I love I love being there. And they have to watch out for me. You know, they call me and want to know where I am and what I'm doing all the time. And I'll be like, you know, just I'm okay. Carlene and I, this is my last story because it involves Fred Hammond. We got into this skincare business. It was like a pyramid, right? But we didn't want to move up in rank. We didn't care about making money. We just wanted to make people beautiful because that was our forte. That's what we did. So I remember one time Carlene called Fred Hammond, and I lost my mind because I'm something like, you know, like a commission groupie too. And Fred, you never did let us get to that facial. I'm really upset about it, and I think that Carlene will want you to allow me to do that on her behalf, okay? So that's really what I want to say. To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord, and the present is a gift. I thank God for the gift of my beautiful sister. I thank God for walking in that church and seeing her face there, because she was one of the reasons why I knew I would never leave as long as she and Mitch were there. I used to go down and with BJ to the youth ministry. I love young people. And I enjoyed every moment of sitting with them. Carlene left a beautiful legacy. A beautiful legacy of love and of God. Even me, Lord. And I just want to say thank you, God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you.
Good morning again. My name is Linda Harper. I'm one of the pastors and elders at the Dunamis Outreach Ministries. It's an honor to be here. It's an honor to be in your house, Bishop Ellis, and to speak for a few minutes about my sister, Carlene. Carlene and I became friends as soon as I came to the ministry, and that was back in 1994. She tells the funny story about how she was really trying to be my friend, but I was trying to avoid it, but that's not true. But after a while, I developed a nickname for Carlene, and it was Carlene, Darlene, Charlene. So every time I saw her, I would say, hey, Carlene, Darlene, Charlene. And she would just laugh because, you know, she had that deep throaty laugh. And we became good friends. Many times I would meet her and Mitch after Bible study or one day in the week, and we would go and like swarm on restaurants. And one of my funniest stories, I'm gonna tell the whole story, is about how I was over at the house one day on Christmas. She invited me to come over on Christmas, and she was cooking fish on Christmas. You would have to know Carlene, cooking fish on Christmas. And Mitch was watching sports on television, and she and I just laughed. And she was combing Gabby's hair, and it was just comical. That's all I can say. It was just comical. I think about all those wonderful things, those laughs. She and I would sit and we would talk about how we were going to solve the problems of the world. If you know Carlene, she had a beautiful, but she had this strict line of holiness and decorum that the people of God should. She was a fellow elder. We would pray together. If you wanted a warrior on your side, you would want Carlene on your side. Would pray down heaven, had an accurate prophetic gift. Beautiful, funny, fashionable, very opinionated, precious, perfect. That's Carlene. I love her. I say love. I speak in the present tense because God is the God of the living. And she lives. I've heard reference today about to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. That is true. She lives. She lives not just through Mitch, not just through the children. She lives because she touched the earth. There are people who are saved because she lives. There are people who are delivered because she lives. And we laughed. And I will miss seeing her, but this is the good news. I'll see her again. Forever. That's the good news. So always praying for you, Mitch Man and BJ and Adrian. Praying for Dunamis because there's a big hole. Carlene, darling, Charlene. An incredible, not just an, but an incredible woman. Multifaceted, anointed, appointed. And she was just a bad girl. Amen.
I am honored to have words for my friend because I loved her so. Rumor had it that Mitchell Jones had married the most beautiful girl in the world. That was the rumor. I had not yet met her, but the rumor was that he has married the most beautiful girl in the world. I'm at Gantles at Northland, and I'm shopping, walking around, and I see the most beautiful girl in the world. And the thing with that is she is pregnant with Adrian. How can you be the most beautiful girl in the world and you're pregnant? We strike up a conversation, and from that moment, a friendship of close to 40 years began. I loved Carlene because you can be the most beautiful girl in the world, but you could also make everyone else feel like they are the most. You have to be really grounded. You have to be really secure and wonderful on the inside to be able to share your glory. And that's what Carlene was so able to do. She is a thread. She is a thread throughout my life. Our families went on vacations together. She is my daughter's godmother. Trina Temple, Carlene and I start this wives group that lasted. We met every Thursday for 2 years. Wow, the wonder of a wife. And opinionated, determined to make sure that every woman that came apart, that you were going to be the best wife possible. And yet being the most beautiful girl in the world, she allowed others to rise as well. Our lives are epistles read by men. Our lives are letters that men will read. And Carlene, if we just look around this room, surely we can say that her life was a love letter to us Her life was an encouraging letter to us. Her life was a strong letter. Her letter was a correcting letter. Her letter would say that you can do all things through Christ who strengthens you, and you can stay to the very end, stay committed to what God has given you. I often, in moments like this, walk away and just try to say, now what can I take away from these services? And one thing that I've always thought, that we now, God is so good because he allows us an opportunity to still write our letters. Some of us might need to tear up the letter and start all over again and erase it, change some lines. But the wonderful thing about that is God gives us that opportunity. And what we can stand and say in that last paragraph of Carlene's letter is that she stood firm to the end. She did not change her testimony. She did not change that there is nothing too hard for our God. That never changed. And so today, I don't know, that came to my heart for us to have a moment that if we need to rewrite our letters, the letters that men will read, let's do that in honor of Cartelina. Elder Harper says she called her Darlene, Charlene, Carlene, Marlene. For me, she was Cartelina. Every time I saw her, Cartelina, because she had her school that many of us were a part of, Cartelina. And so as we stand here and we're here today, we can honor her and continue to shine so bright as she was the most beautiful girl in the world. God bless you all.
Give God praise to all of these that have given remarks. And at this time, Pastor Mitchell and his family will come, and they will all come together. And I believe his daughter is going to go first, and then his son, and then Pastor Mitchell. And while they're coming, there are so many, Pastor Mitchell and his family have touched so many churches, and he got his beginning at Great Apostolic Temple, now pastor by, amen, Pastor Marty Allen. Stand up, Pastor Marty Allen. That's where he got his upbringing, and the church on Woodrow and Milford, and then coming over to Greater Grace and other ministries, and now at Dunamis. And what a blessing that they have blessed all of our ministries, and our ministries are what they are because he and his family have passed through and have impacted. There are so many pastors that are here that Mitch has sung at your church and sang at your church and provided workshops of music ministries or what have you. And of course, there could not be that much time in this program to accommodate you all. We did Rosa Parks' funeral at 7 hours and 45 minutes. And I thought that was going to be the record, but Aretha's was 8 hours, 36 minutes, and 50 seconds. I know, amen. But all of our pastors that are in the audience here on today that are here to support this family, maybe you didn't get a chance to speak to them, and maybe you won't. Maybe you'll have to leave early or won't be afforded that time. Please stand now so they can look around. They can see all of the pastors and ministers, men and women of the cloth that are here today that are supporting. Amen. God bless you, Apostle. Amen. All of those on the rostrum, please stand. Bishop Brooks and Pastor Robbie Warren, please stand. Pastor Staten, and so many others. Thank you so very kindly. You may be seated.
Hi. I wanted to write this down because I wanted to make sure I didn't miss anything. But Carlene was my mom, my sister, my bestie, and the best nana to my kids. You know, I can get up and say how much I loved her, but I want to emphasize how much she loved me and her family. She would travel to the ends of the earth for me and our family. Even during her hard times of her battle, she never played the victim. She was always trying to make our lives easier, babysitting the grands, praying for others, looking beautiful as ever on her Facebook Live, selling her paparazzi jewelry, and being a confidant to those who needed her. I was a mama's girl. I would talk to my mom 100 times a day. I would call her before work, during work, after work, and when she worked at Macy's, we would meet for lunch. And everywhere I worked, they knew Carlene. We were the perfect mom and daughter duo. You know, I wanted to share something with you guys. In December, my mom told me that, you know, if this was her time to go, that she had no regrets, and she lived a wonderful, fulfilling life. She felt that God would be pleased. And that is a blessing, because I don't believe that if a lot of us went today, we could say those same things. You know, and if we couldn't, why not? You know, what could we change about today? You know, and I wanted to use this time to give God a shout out, because that's what my mom would do. I want to tell you that my mom was even more wonderful because of her faith and that the God that she served, viewing obstacles as half full, telling everyone that she could about God. Saints, it's the time to rise up and fully surrender to God. Don't be afraid of what others will think. God is worth the sacrifice of looking like a fool to others. Those of you who don't know God, you should be asking more questions and eager to find out about the God she served. Will you be ready like Carlene? Mom, I want you to know that during this hardest time of my life, I have never been so close to God. Everything you taught me about faith, I will never discard. I will always keep God first and do my best to teach my children diligently. I promise to keep your memory alive so that your grandbabies will never forget you. You were the best, and I will miss you so much. I promise to make you proud. Now I have one of the strongest guardian angels watching over me. Rest well, Mom.
Mom, you are more than just a mother in love. You are a spiritual mother, a marriage counselor, and a friend. God surpassed my prayers of marrying into a beautiful family. I told Mitchell, if your parents didn't want us to get married, I will respect their wishes. Mom and Dad were spiritual coverings for many. I was new to my walk with God, and I quickly learned it was a whole nother world. Mom would talk to me for hours. When I first started dating Mitchell, she had a testimony for everything you were going through, and she was gonna pray for everything. If I needed a job, if I had a headache, if I needed anything, we went to God. Many could not believe Dad and Mom were our marriage counselors. Before Mitchell asked if it was okay, I knew it was a strong yes. I had already been carefully watching her as a wife to Dad. I would ask Mom, how did she do it? How did you stay married in today's society? I had no problem sharing with her our ups and downs. She was the perfect combination of the spirit and the natural. She never had a biased opinion, and she always spoke the word of God. Mom even became one of my girls. After a year and a half of dating Mitchell, we became engaged. And about 3 weeks later, it was our birthday. Her birthday was January 13th, and mine was January 14th. We made sure we celebrated all month. And she always made sure I had my vegan options. Then Adrian, Mom, and I became a group. We were called the Woman of God. We had fun, we prayed, we ranted, and Mom was just our sister, our spiritual counselor, and our friend. We're gonna love you, Mom.
I, too, am a mama's boy. I have a million things to say, and I'm going to spare you the 8 hours. I can literally talk for a whole day just about my mom. I have a few things that I wanted to say. Her royalty. My mom, although she had a public expression, like, you know, her being a model and all that, my dad was a singer. their expression in the home was so organic. It was like the Huxtables, you know? And just her strength, her covering, everything about her. Like, it's like not that you're looking for something wrong, but it's just like, can't be that good. It can't be that good of a person, you know? Like, what you guys say about her in public, she was that in secret, you know? And that's not common. It's not common at all. You know, public is where we put on a face, and then at home is where we kind of lay our hair down. But she presented to us as a mother and a friend her all. She gave her all, you know? I remember when I was a kid, my first experience of my parents were them praying for people, you know? I remember being a young kid and like hospices, and they would be just praying. Like every week we would go to a hospice and they would just be praying for people. And that marked me for a beautiful person to contend, to see people through, to see people healed, to suffer with them. In secret, no cameras, no microphones, no nothing. That's something that my mother really did that I cherish. She lived in secret. Everyone who has been affected by her has been affected by her friendship. She was a friend, you know? And I remember I struggled with depression and a few things as a kid. And I used to I was the type of kid that hated myself. And my mother would always pick up on it. She would always pick up on the heart things that I was dealing with that nobody saw. And that's a gift. That's a gift. And that kept me, that covered me. Like, I would probably have committed suicide if I didn't have my mom in my life, because she was teaching me how to fight, how to believe that I'm loved, how to believe that I have a purpose, I have a meaning. That's what I'm living out now. And and she was always every broken season of like me seeing a brokenness in the world, bullies, she was always introducing me to the Lord. Always, always. You want to receive the Holy Spirit today? No, I'm okay. She was always introducing me to the unseen person of God, to show me that there's more to life than you think. And that introduction in my home was actually what we're supposed to experience in our home, you know? And that has kept me, that's covered me. And I'm thankful for that. Her heart, she loved her friends. Like, I remember all my mom's friends, and you guys are here, all her friends, not church family, friends. You know, she made known the friendship of Jesus. You know, a lot of times we think Jesus wants us to do things, he wants us to all this, but he told his disciples, like, no longer do I call you servants, I call you friends. So that relationship, that friendship was the highest quality. And I seen that in my mother, you know. Just a few more things. I wanted to actually encourage my dad. I'm thankful to have seen your example, you know, to have seen, like, beyond fairy tale, beyond movie type of love, you know, like, to see it more in the home than you do in public is like, it's Jesus. That's what he taught us. He taught us to live in secret, to love in secret. And I'm thankful to have seen your representation of Christ's love for his bride. Thankful for that. To my sister, I see mom's strength in you. I see her strength. I see. I see that same strength, that same love, that same beauty that flows from within, that is not trying to be something in front of man, but is living before God, you know? And that hospitality, the grace that was on our grandmother, that everybody would flock to her home. And my mother is the same thing. Everybody would flock to her home. And now it's you. That grace, that hospitality has been passed down. Thankful for you. to my wife and my kids, I am so proud. Jasmine, I'm so proud of you. I'm proud that you consider my mom as your mom, that you contended for her health because of your love for her, because of love. We did this not out of fear of prevention, but because of love. And I'm thankful for you, Jasmine. You represented me when I wasn't present. When I wasn't able to go to the hospital, you represented me wholeheartedly. You know, to the body, to everyone who was here who loved her, I am so thankful to have received the tribe. Like they say, it takes a village to raise a child. And you guys raised me.
Right, right.
Yeah, I'm so thankful for you guys. And, you know, the River family, she loved you. And even the people on the River call that we had as our immediate family, she loved you. We loved each other. We discovered a love that is beyond measure. And to mom, I am so thankful and proud of you. I'm proud of you for fighting the good fight. I'm proud of you for showing love even when you were suffering. You showed me how to suffer. You showed me how to live a life. Before God, I'm thankful for you, and I am forever indebted to multiply that love that you had in the earth. Thank you.
I give honor to Bishop Ellis, Commission, my brothers, and everybody that's here, and Pastor Kelly and Dunamis Outreach Ministry. When I tell you, I feel the love. I feel the love, y'all. This is what we need. We need the love. I thank God for all of y'all. Hallelujah. When I listen to everybody, and I listen to what everybody's saying about Carlene, or Carlene, darling, Charlene, Marlene, Cartelina, or my China doll, I realize that the story is really not about Carlene. When you look at David, some people think the story was about him, or Joshua, or Jeremiah. But the story is not about them, really not about Carlene. It's about God and the life of Carlene. Yeah. And he was able to express himself through her. So much so that she would shine the light. She would shine life, light, and love to everybody she came in contact with. They enjoyed, just like me, enjoyed just being with her. Our love language was quality time, so we always just enjoyed just being together. It was so phenomenal to have a woman who loved God, who loved the Word, that we can share with one another and encourage one another to live the life that God intended. It's nothing like that, y'all, I'm telling you. To have a woman who was so crazy about God that she'd be giving you revelation. Man, and would pray every time. I mean, I would go through certain things and she would pray and manifestations would happen. I remember a time I was real. I mean, I was sick, I couldn't breathe, and my wife laid hands on me. And healing came forth. I'm telling you, y'all, men who are married, love your wives. Go out the way. Love your wives. I'm telling you, love your wives. One thing she told me, she said, on my 50th birthday, she said, all the years we've been married, I never felt that you didn't love me. And you know how that make a man feel? That's all I wanted, man. That's all I wanted. She said she asked God for a man who loved God, who loves her, and would help her make it in. Hallelujah.
It was such an honor to love someone like that. When I think about when we first got together, let me go back a little further. I was graduated at Mumford High School, as Bishop said, one of the Mumford High before. I was an A&M studio, and I think MacArthur was the owner of that A&M studio on 7 Mile. Yeah, and Schaefer. And I happened to look up and I saw these high school pictures, and I happened to see this girl. I said, man, who was that? He said, man, don't worry about that. She out of your league. So 6 years later, I happened to meet this young lady at the skating party at Wheels. And when I saw her, she was sitting down. And I was kind of nervous. All I noticed was, if y'all ever met Tim Conway, all I noticed was, I found myself going over there and I said, hey, would you like to skate? She said, yes. So we skated, we had a good time, we hit it off. And we didn't see or talk to each other for a whole year. But we came back and met at Wheels End again. Sorry, Wheels. Was it Wheels Inn or was it Wheels Skate Park? Wheels. And so we hit it off again. 3 months, we would get dating. 6 months later, we were married. But in the 6 month period, when I opened up a portfolio, I happened to notice that picture that was in A&M still. So when I seen MacArthur, I said, you thought I was out of her league, but I happened to be in that league. Why? You know why? Because grace was multiplied unto me. Oh yeah. Now see, I know that there's not a lot of people can say they can have a woman like that. She's definitely beautiful. She wasn't just a beautiful face. She was a beautiful soul. She was genuine. She was true. She wasn't fake. She was always teaching, always encouraging you or someone to be the best version of themselves. She would never call you out, but she would call you up. She was always wanting you and everybody she come in contact to be the best person that they can be in Christ all the time. And I love how, man, I love how she loved me unconditionally, y'all. I mean, she loved me unconditionally. She loved me when I was right and when I was wrong. And I'm telling you, it's nobody like my Carlene, man. It's nobody like when Pastor Kelly said she was the beautiful woman, most beautiful woman in the world. I definitely thought she was. And when my sister said that in her eyes, I was every woman's dream, well, in my eyes, she was definitely every man's dream. You better believe it.
Hallelujah.
What I love about her too, is she was always determined. No matter what we was going through, she was always determined to make the best of every situation. She taught me, she said, see the glass half full, not half empty. Always give people the benefit of the doubt. I love you, baby. Wonderful wife, and you will always be the lady of my life.
Come on, give this family and the strength that God has given them a great hand on today. And through their tears and through their sorrow, yet able to share. Brothers and sisters, we're going to have musical renderings, and then you're going to hear the eulogy from Pastor Dwight Knight. Detroit has had some indelible, both secular and gospel sounds. Someone said that if there was no Motown, music like that would have never graced this world. And we like to think that Detroit has had the best gospel sounds. Somebody said, well, Bishop, Reverend James Cleveland back in the day, Reverend James Cleveland spent many years at Prayer Tabernacle Church as the minister of music. So while he was in Chicago, went to school with my dad, Reverend Cleveland is Detroit as well. So I will say again, Detroit has the most prolific musical sounds that this world has ever heard. And we have it in all flavors, Keith. We've got contemporary, we've got old gospel, you name it, quartet, we've got it all. But you're now getting ready to be blessed by the sounds that have lived forever. And we've watched it mature, and now it has become a legacy of gospel music to this very day and throughout eternity. Please put your hands together and stand and receive commission as they come and share.
Just before we get into that, we want BJ Jones. He wants to do a song. Can y'all give him some love right now? Come on, BJ.
Let's worship the Lord. You are my Lord, that's why I sing to after us. We see you, Lord, reaching after us. Alleluia. Alleluia. Thank you for loving me through my mother. Thank you for loving me through my mother. I felt your love embrace through my mother. Nothing like a mother's love that's flowing from your love. Nothing like a mother that's submitted to you, God, that surrendered to you and leads me to you, God. So one more time we sing hallelujah.
Let's just lift your hands all over this place. Come on, come on, come on. I said, come on, lift your hands all over this place. Let's just begin to worship. Can we worship for one moment right here? I know Sister Carlene would want us to go into a little bit of worship before. Come on, can you just stand to your feet right now and lift your hands and just begin to bless the Lord? Come on, somebody bless him. Somebody give him praise. Somebody give him glory. Somebody, come on, open up your mouth and say, bless the Lord, oh my soul. And all that's within me, bless his holy name. Now, I spoke with Mitchell earlier this week. And I said, Brother Mitchell, I said, listen up. What were some of the Carlene's favorite songs? And he said, man, he had so many favorite commission songs. And he started to name some songs, and he eventually got to the song I knew he was going to say, and that was Ordinary Just Won't Do. So I'm going to have the fellas come. Can we come on, fellas? We come on, Jim. Come on up, fellas. You got to understand, this is an emotional moment for all the guys in commission, because Carlene was there day one. And so we get a little teary-eyed and we begin to worship and thank God for the life of Carlene Lindsay-Jones. Don't you never mind, just go on and join in with us as we begin to worship the Lord. Come on, Brother Parks.
We do honor the Lord today. Pray it. We thank the Lord for what we've heard, for when someone has lived a life like Carlene, this is the demonstrated love of Christ. It's a lot I could say. I will tell you this. From day one, me and Mitch, we played ball together. We did everything together. We used to go to his mom's house and we'd be playing piano and getting these songs. And I used to be late picking up my wife because we was in there trying to write and write. Then all of a sudden, I noticed he get a little edgy around about a certain time. I didn't know what was up, right? Because usually I'm the one late. Little green sports car pulls up. I gotta go, man, I gotta go. All you hear was beep, beep. I don't care, we was in the middle of it writing a new verse. He got up off that piano so fast. He got off that piano, he said, I gotta go. So when I went outside and I looked in the car, I said, I understand. And so when me and Carlene met, we had this thing going on from day one. We laughed, we joked. My nickname for her was the Anointed Cherub. And then I called her the Most High. And she reveled in all of it, BJ. She reveled in all of it. And we had this thing going back and forth. In the early days, I could get her, you know? In my latter days, I said, Carlene, I said, I ain't got it like I used to got it. I said, you win. You win. We laughed so much. What I liked about her, she let me cry. She let me be vulnerable. We would talk about the word. We would talk about life, the problems I had. Man, sometimes Carlene would sit in the driveway. We would talk to 2 and 3 in the morning. And didn't even know how fast time was going. And she'd get up the next day and call. Yeah, you remember we were saying this last night? The word said this, and what you think about this? And we was constant going. But she was a diligent seeker and a lover of God's word. And she loved her family. She just loved people in general. And she paid the highest compliment I think you could pay. She said, I wouldn't have anybody else. And I don't think anybody else can take care of me like Mitchell is taking care of me. Those were her words. Her words. You know what that's called? Extraordinary. It's not an ordinary love. It's an extraordinary love. Thank you.
Someone is you. Yeah.
Someone is you.
I don't need it.
an ordinary love. I need a special kind of love. Yeah, yeah. I quest and on to find
you,
you lies in the heart, the soul and the mind. Sometimes serenity, but then there's a so many witnesses and falls. I've got to learn
to hear the secret.
Ordinary person just won't do. I need someone, Lord. I need someone.
That someone is you.
That someone is you.
That someone
is you. Lord, I need your special touch. It would mean so very much.
Yeah. All those friends, they don't see.
Understand your power in your life.
Problems in your life.
So come on.
Supply your needs,
sweet and gentle touch, yeah. Then we speak a word of love that means so much. The ordinary just wonderful. I need someone, yes I do.
That someone is you,
yeah, yeah.
That someone is
because
you.
The ordinary just won't know. I need all this feeling joy. Can always find it in you, Jesus. You can always find it in you, Jesus.
Just wonder, I need love that's pure and true. I can always find it in you, Jesus.
Ordinary,
just wonder, can I have a touch from you? I can always find it in you, Jesus. The ordinary, just wonder, I need love that's pure and true. I can always find it in you.
Wow.
The ordinary just won't do well. God, I have a touch from you. I can always find it in you. The ordinary just won't do well. I can always find it in you, Jesus. The ordinary just won't do well. God, I have a touch from you. I can always find it in you.
Has been hard. Oh,
it's not an ordinary love.
It's not an ordinary love. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Oh, say it again.
It's not an ordinary love.
The love that taught me sinking out in the sea, walked on water and pulled me to my feet. It's an ordinary
love.
Ordinary love,
ordinary love.
Yeah.
It's not an ordinary love.
Sing it again, yeah, yeah. It's not an ordinary love.
It's not an ordinary love.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, my, oh, my. It's not an ordinary love.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Listen, the very first song we ever sang together was The City. Can we do that right now, brothers? Here we go.
Away our tears,
I admit when Mitch called me the other day and asked me to do the eulogy, I didn't feel worthy. Of all the great men and women of God that have come in and out of Carlene and Mitch's life, many of them here today, Bishop Ellis, Pastor Kelly Lane, Ty Temple, to be asked to do this, I'm humbled. And I say this with all sincerity. Carlene was not just my sister in the Lord. She was my sister, period. When I decided that it was time for me to get married, and I let Mitch and Carlene know that, Carlene whispered to me while I was at Dome. She said, "I'm gonna help you." And she did. To this great woman of God, I am forever indebted. Forever indebted. When I started to travel quite a bit, I know tons of people. I have tons of friends. But I am kind of a conundrum. While I speak to a lot of people and I minister a lot, I've never accepted the many opportunities or many offers I had to be a pastor. And the reason why is very simple and it's very godly. I don't like people. I love people, but I don't like being around them that much. Now that's the raison d'etre for Dwight Knight. I love y'all, but y'all go home. But in my many travels, I am very particular about my environment. And I'm what is known as an extreme extrovert. Now what that means is that while I'm an extreme extrovert, deeply embedded in that extrovertedness, I am a closet introvert. That means I want to get all the people I can together, and they know each other and they love each other, so they can leave me alone. I don't have to have no conversation. I can wave and say hi, but y'all get together and enjoy yourselves in Jesus' name and go home. As you know, Mitch and Carlene were very active at Dome. And when Pastor Reggie Lane asked me to be on the Board of Regents, an elder from distance, because he knew my ministry, what my ministry was about. And I started coming to Dome in and out. They'd have me speak and preach a couple of times. And when I got to Dome, I said, man, all of these beautiful women. Katrina Temple, Kelly Lane, Prophetess, Carlene. But you know what? I'm gonna say this, and Dome taught me this, and I have gone all over the world several times. No man, no matter how godly, no matter how good, no matter how handsome, no man of God or any other man deserves his wife. I've never met a man who deserved his wife. His wife was always the pinnacle of God's proof that he loves him. And these are Carlene's words to me. A good man marries up. He always marries somebody that's better than him to make him better. And that's what Carlene was. When I took all my vacations, I had one rule. I wanted Mitch and Carlene there. Of all the people I knew, I wanted Mitch and Carlene there. And Carlene would somehow be able to light up a room with her presence and with her beauty, but never, never once in the 35, almost 40 years I've known her, did I ever feel conceit or pride or arrogance. She emulated the love of Christ. But let me tell you something. I say this to you, Mitch. Every time I encountered her, in every way, she reflected her love for you and for her children. That woman loved you to death. And you know that. Mitch is my dear friend, and I love him madly. But when I saw his wife, I said, why do you like him so much, God? Why in the world do you love him so much? But that's the woman for the man. That's the woman for the man. And some of the very qualities I saw in Carlene, I look for in my wife. And the moment I saw my wife, I said, oh Lord, how am I going to take care of this woman? I knew that was who God gave me. My devotion, I have devotion every morning at about 4:30 and in the morning. And my devotion that morning was, whosoever findeth a wife, findeth what? A good thing, and obtains favor from the Lord. And that's exactly what my wife has been. And man, it can be said of you, Mitch, you had a good thing. you had a good thing. God loves you. When Daryl Ford introduced me to Mitch years ago at Greater Grace, the old Greater Grace, when Mitch was singing with Saved, remember that, Fred? And he, when we walked away, he introduced me to Mitch, and he walked away and he said this, God just liked Mitch. God just liked Mitch. I said, well, God liked me too. No, but God likes Mitch. That's the truth. I'm not gonna be before you long. I'm just gonna share a few thoughts. My grandfather was also a minister of the Word of God said, you know, Dwight, when I was called in ministry, he says, you know, Dwight, a man who has nothing to say usually takes a long time to say it. And I found that to be true. So I'm gonna say to you the same thing that Liz Taylor said to all eight of her husbands. I'm not gonna keep you long. We'll be out by 7:45 easily. But I do wanna give honor to God and to the bishop of this house, Pastor Kelly Lane. My dear friend, Pastor Mike Dexter, and my best friend, Darnell Fuller, and my own precious wife. I just wanna give honor there. I'm gonna ask you to turn in your Bibles, those of you that have Bibles, I want you to turn your Bibles to the Gospel of John. Chapter 11. I want to point out three things and we'll be on our way. Gospel of John, chapter 11. As you know, this is the story of the death of Lazarus and his encounter with the Lord Jesus Christ. John chapter 11, verse 17, it says this. Then when Jesus came, he found that he had lain in the grave 4 days already. Now Bethany was nigh unto Jerusalem, about 15 furlongs off. And many of the Jews came to Mary, Martha and Mary to comfort them concerning their brother. Then Martha, as soon as she heard that Jesus was coming, went and met him. But Mary stayed still in the house. Then said Martha unto Jesus, Lord, if thou hadst been here, my brother had not died. But I know that even now, whatsoever thou would ask of God, God will give it to thee. Jesus said unto her, thy brother shall rise again. Martha said unto him, I know that he shall rise again in the resurrection at the last day. And Jesus said unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever believeth and believeth in me shall never die. Believest thou this? And she said unto him, yea, Lord, I believe that thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God, which should come into the world. And when she had said so, she went her way and called Mary, her sister, secretly, saying, the master is come and calleth for thee. And as soon as she heard that, she arose up quickly and came unto him. Now Jesus was not yet come into the town, was in the place where Martha had met him. Then the Jews which were with her in the house, comforted her. When they saw Mary, they rose up and hastily went out, followed her, weeping and saying, she goeth in the grave to weep there. Then when Mary was come whence Jesus was, she saw him and fell down at his feet and said unto him the same thing. Lord, if thou hadst been here, my brother had not died. When Jesus therefore saw her weeping and the Jews also weeping, which came unto her, he groaned in his spirit and was troubled. and said, "Where have you laid him?" They said, "Lord, come and see." Jesus wept. Then said the Jews, "Behold how he loved him." And some of them said, "Could not this man, which opened the eyes of the blind, have caused that even this man should not have died?" Lord, we lift up our face to you, and we bless your name. We worship you. We glorify you. We sorrow not because we're not those that have no hope. But we rest in you. We trust in you. We depend on your comfort, and we worship you and thank you for being the God of our life. In Jesus' name, amen. Like I said, I won't be long. I just want to bring three thoughts to your mind. The scripture says in verse number 32, when Mary was come where Jesus was and saw him, she fell down at his feet and said unto him, "Lord, if thou hast been here, my brother had not died." When Jesus therefore saw her weeping, the Jews also weeping, which came with her, he groaned in the spirit and was troubled and said, "Where have you laid him?" And they said, "Lord, come and see." Three things. The Lord, his lament, and his life. The evangelist Mark took time to highlight the lordship of the Lord Jesus Christ. He was Lord of the spirits, the demons. He was Lord of the scriptures. He was Lord of the sea. He was Lord of the Sabbath. He was Lord over sickness. He was Lord over sin. He was Lord. And let me tell you something, no matter where you are, no matter what you believe, if Jesus is not Lord, if he's not master, if he's not absolute controller and sovereign of the universe, you in trouble. You say, "Dwight, I come to church, I read my Bible, I believe." Listen, there ain't nothing special. The demons believe, and they got enough sense to tremble. But Paul's confession of faith starts like this: if thou wilt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus. See, Jesus has got to be in control. See, I don't believe that Jesus should be first in your life. He should be only. He's only. There's no second place, no third choice, no fourth option. No, he should be Lord. And Lord means that he's in control, sovereign control of everything. I was, when I was still working, years ago, I was in a department, I was in a management department, and some guys, you know how people talk at you, but then when they don't want to talk to you. And two guys were talking at me because they knew I was a Christian, they knew I was a preacher of the Word of God. And they said to each other, but at me, "There's no such thing as God. There's no such thing as God." And I was passing by as they were looking at me when they were saying it. "There's no such thing as God." I said, "I agree with you." And they said, "What? Thought you were a preacher." I said, "I am a preacher." "And you agree that there's no such thing as God?" I said, "Yes. God's not a thing. God is not a thing. God's a living, active, life-giving spirit. The reason why you don't believe in God, because God is not a thing." I said, "What surprises me
is not that you don't believe in the God, but you don't believe in the devil. And they said, wait, whoa, there's a devil? I said, yeah, there's a devil. He's your father. Y'all are relatives, close relatives. Everything you do is wrong. The Bible says the plowing of the wicked is sin. When you take a breath in and out, you're sinning before God. The Bible says God is angry with the sinner all day long. Scripture says, you are of your father, the devil, and the lust of your father you will do. One of them, his name was Larry, caught me downstairs going to lunch, and he pulled me inside and says, tell me more about this God. Could you tell me some more about this God? I said, well, I have to tell you about my friend. He said, well, I want to know about God. I said, my friend. He's my Lord. He's my Savior. He's my confidant, my comforter, but he's my friend. I accepted Christ when I was 4 years old, and I knew exactly what I was doing. I knew exactly what I was doing at 4 years old. And while other people have had some struggles in their life, and they may have backslidden here and there, but I want to tell you something, not glorifying Dwight, but I have never backslidden. I've walked with Jesus every day since then, because that's the kind of God he is. He meets every one of my needs. He's Lord of my life. Lord means that he is control. He is in sovereign control of everything. And some of you all waver in your prayer life, and you waver in your church life and your worship life, because it seems that there are temporary avenues that would satisfy you more. All those things happen to people in and out of the church. It's amazing to me how many people duck in and duck out for their be kind of God moment. But if he ain't Lord, you in trouble. Then the scripture says, when Jesus therefore saw her weeping, and the Jews also weeping which came by with her, he groaned in the spirit and was troubled. And he said, where have you laid him? And he said unto him, Lord, come and see. Jesus wept. His lament. There's only two times in the Bible, in all the word, where it's recorded that Jesus wept. Once over Jerusalem, and once at the graveside of Lazarus. And the answer to that for both of them is the same thing. Jesus didn't cry, break down in tears, I mean bitter tears, because his friend Lazarus would die. No, Lazarus would get up from the grave in a few minutes. He wasn't worried about that. Jesus wept not for his friend Lazarus only, not that this man died, but all. The reason why is because all men had to die. Back in that pre-incarnate state, man decided in paradise, I want anything but God in my life. And I believe from that moment on, God looked at his creation and it broke his heart. His lament, his torment, his burning agony in his heart was so overwhelming. He said, listen, I've sent to them prophets and priests and kings and teachers, but if you want something done right, you got to do it yourself.
So he put on the robe of temporality, the robe of flesh, the robe of being limited with one purpose in mind. Yeah, he did a lot of miracles. Yeah, he said a lot of wonderful things. Yet he touched a lot of people. But he had one goal in mind. Book of Luke tells us that his face was steadfastly for the cross. The only thing that would solve God's anguish and his pain was to die for man. You see, we don't present a gospel that is all feel good. We don't present a gospel that makes it easy for people to live in their sin. We don't live a compromised gospel. Watch me now. We don't live a compromised gospel where you can sleep with anything you want to and still stand before God and worship him. I'm getting in trouble here. We don't preach a gospel. We don't live a gospel where a woman can shack up with a woman and a man can shack up with a man, but because they can sing or because they can hoop, it's all right. No, we don't have that kind of gospel. My Jesus didn't die for that kind of gospel. Young man came up to me at Clemson University. He heard I was going to speak, and he said, "What are you going to speak on, preacher?" I said, "Well, I try to be led by the Holy Spirit." He said, "Well, if you're going to bash gays and talk about homosexuals, I don't want to hear it." I said, "Well, I'm not going to bash homosexuals. I actually feel sorry for y'all guys." He said, "You feel sorry for me? You shouldn't feel sorry to me." I said, "Listen, man. Number one problem you have is not that you're gay, but that you're lost. You're lost. You're going to a devil's hell. And while you think you found something that makes you a person, I'm telling you, you believe in a lie. We don't preach the kind of gospel that makes people feel good. While it is a feel-good gospel in that it answers all the needs of man, but we don't preach a gospel that allows you to go home and feel good about yourself when you get drunk or you shoot your dope up and you get high on your weed. We don't preach that kind of gospel. In his lament, in his tears, wrapped up in the cloak of his emotion was every single man and woman in the world. And the pain of their depravity and the pain of their foolishness and in the pain of their anguish, he wept. Because God did not create man to die. God did not create the object of his love to go to hell. And so for that reason, he sent his only begotten son to die on the cross for all of mankind. See, that's why Jesus wept. Because until he got to the cross, man had to die. Man had to die. But if it stopped there, the story would be over. If it stopped there, there'd be no hope. There'd only be a comma. But that's not what we're rushing to. Look what the next verse says. It says in verse number 36, "Then said the Jews, behold how he loved me." Let me pause there. two of the greatest statements that were made about Jesus Christ were made by people who hated him. Pharisees and Sadducees said the two things on earth, two of the greatest things on earth about the Lord Jesus Christ, and they didn't even know what they meant by it. In Luke chapter 15, it says, this man welcomes sinners. And the Pharisees got and huddled themselves together and said, this man welcomes sinners. You know what I say to that? Hallelujah. This man welcomes sinners. You ain't saved. I'm not saved. If he don't welcome sinners, guess what heaven is populated with? Sinners. I met a young lady years ago from Bermuda. And she and her sister was asking me all kinds of questions. And her sister said to me, you know why my sister is asking you all these questions? I said, no, why? She said, because she's not saved. I said, she's not saved? And I looked at her sister in the face and I said, why aren't you saved? She said, because the church is full of hypocrites. I said, no, it isn't, honey. It's full of sinners. Come and be one with us. Give your heart to Jesus Christ. An amazing thing happened. She broke down and started crying. And she said, would God accept me? I said, if he can accept me, he can accept you. And she gave her heart to Jesus Christ. And the next morning, we were on a cruise. And the next morning, before I spoke, did our Bible study, I said, this young lady who's on the cruise with us, who's your cruise director, has an announcement she wants to make. The Bible says that we have to confess him as Lord. And she got up in front of hundreds of people. And she said, last night, I gave my heart. And before she could get the words out, every single person that was part of our group rushed the stage and lifted her up and held her and said, we've been praying for you. We've been praying for you. The reason why we asked you to do this tour and do all of our vacations is because we are praying for you. And the second thing that the sinners said that had never been said on the planet, it says in verse 36, behold how he loved him. Every single blood-bought child, man or woman, boy or girl, that knows Jesus Christ as Savior can say this, behold how he loves me. He loves me. He loves me. He loves me. In the quiet watches of the night, he loves me. He never goes to sleep. He loves me. He never leaves me alone. He loves me. He loves me. Mitch, God loves you. He loves you. We can tell that not because he gave you a wonderful wife, but he gave you beautiful kids and grandkids. He loves you. You ought to buy a bumper sticker and put on your car. He loves me. But going on, it says in verse 37, and I'll be finished then. And some said, could not this man, which opened the eyes of the blind, have caused that even this man should not have died? The love of Jesus Christ is transcendent of time and eternity. His love for mankind is like a burning fever. He could not stand by and watch his heart love be plunged into hell. He could not sit still on his throne in heaven and watch us pass through time and eternity and go to hell without doing something about it. He loves you. He loves me. Now, please follow this fact. We got to deal with the elephant in the room. We've heard about a wonderful woman that Carlene Jones was. We heard about from her husband what a wonderful wife she was. And she was a wonderful wife to Mitch. We've heard from her children and her grandchildren what a wonderful mother she was. Well, if God really loved her, why did he take her home so early? I had a friend about 20 years ago. Her name was Cordelia Dudley. She lived in Chicago, and I had known her for many years. And just 4 months prior to that day, she had gotten married. She was married a wonderful man of God. And she was going on a plane to down to Florida to meet her new husband's family. And while she was on that plane, all of a sudden, for no reason anybody can explain, her heart exploded and she died. And when I got the word that from her husband that she had died, I looked toward heaven in my father's face and I said, Lord, why did you take the Cordy from me? Why'd you take her? She was in the prime of her life. She was 31 years old. Why did you take her? Of all the people, all the women who had compromised life, who lived any kind of life they wanted to live, that did not live for you, why did you take Cordy? She didn't even have time to become a mother. Why did you take her? And audibly, as loud as I am speaking to you, the Holy Spirit spoke to my heart and said, Dwight, why do you think that being with me is such a bad thing? What made you believe that it's better to stay on earth in hell all around you, hell in front of you, hell behind you, hell all around you? And the first thing that Cordy saw when she opened her eyes was not angels singing, was not the streets paved with gold, but saw me. What made you think that that's a bad thing? Now, I want to ask you quickly, and I'm going to be done, I promise you. Do you really think that the devil got any kind of victory in this situation? That God did not answer Mitch's prayer? That God didn't answer BJ's prayer? That God didn't answer Adrian's prayer? God didn't answer all the prayers of the saints at Dome and everyone that knew her? Why did you think that God ignored all of our prayers that went forth, Carlene? Why do you think that he still deserves worship when we're here today? But let me tell you, even today, God is still busting up funerals. He's still showing up at funerals. Maybe not in the way you think, but he's busting up funerals. You see, the answer to all of our prayers is this: either God was going to heal her or he was going to heal her. Either he was going to heal her physical body or he was going to heal her in a perfect body. Paul said like this: I got my straight between two things. I could go to be with Jesus, which is far better, or stay here and be with y'all. In the Bible, there are 76 mentions of the word precious. But in all the scripture, there's only one time the word precious is used as a direct article in the beginning of the sentence. And guess what it says? Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints. Satan never wins the victory. Satan never gets his way. Satan is never should be magnified when a saint goes home. It's hallelujah. It's praise the Lord. We don't come here to have a pity party and cry. Oh yeah, we agree because we'll miss her. But let me tell you something. If given a choice with all the people she loves here on earth, if given a choice between coming back and staying in heaven, I hate to tell you this, while Carlene may love you, Carlene may have some fond memories, but she ain't thinking about you at all. She's looking in the face of Jesus. My favorite one word in the Bible is Jesus, no doubt about that. My favorite two words are right here in verse number 35, Jesus wept. My favorite three words is God is love. My favorite four words is Christ died for us. But my favorite five words is they shall see his face. I have to admit, honestly, that I'm a bit jealous of my sister Carlene. She saw him face to face before I did. She is reveling in the basking in the glory of his presence, able to sing and praise him and worship him every second of every moment face to face. She is with our Lord and she is loving his presence and waiting for all of us to be with him. Saints of God, the love of our Lord Jesus Christ transcends all of our experiences. With you, I grieve the fact that I've lost my sister in this world, but like Pastor Kelly said, I'll see her again. I have that hope. I lost my brother, my dear brother, my older brother, 5 years ago that occurrence was so heavy on me, I had a stroke 2 months later. And his wife asked me to preach the funeral. And I said, that's not fair. That doesn't give me a chance to grieve. And she said, why should you grieve? You're gonna see him again. And like I said, that I know that sometimes in our humanity, we grieve. But the Bible says that we don't sorrow as those that have no hope. We'll see her again. We'll see her again. You know, we are not trinities. Trinity means that three parts, all of them are equal. Man is not a trinity. Man is a tripartite being. I only use that word to let y'all know I went to seminary. But tripartite means he is three parts. And let me tell you something else. We are not body, soul, and spirit. Right, are you crazy? The Bible tells us we're body, soul, and spirit. No, it doesn't. No matter how much you go through your scripture, you'll never find a place, any place, where the Bible calls us body, soul, and spirit. We are spirit, soul, and body. The emphasis being on what's important and what's least important. We are spirit, soul. We're not humans having a spiritual transaction. We are spirit beings having a human transaction. And you use your sanctified imagination. Think of a peanut.
A whole peanut is shell, skin, and seed or nut. You don't eat the shell. That's not the thing you after. You after the nut. If somebody's eating the shell, it's time to put them in Bellevue. And man has been wasting his time beautifying his shell and has lost the priority of the nut. You know what we do with the shell? Get rid of it. This is but a shell. The value, what we really are concerned about, is the seed inside. When she was a very young lady, she accepted the Lord Jesus Christ as her Savior. And I can tell you honestly, by knowing her personally and intimately, every single transaction I ever had with Carlene Jones, she glorified the God of the universe. And the things she did and the people she hung out with, the way she loved her family, she honored the Lord Jesus Christ. May it be said of us that the very God of Carlene Jones is the Lord and maker of our life, and we'll honor him forever. God bless you.
Andrew's funeral home will come at this time. Give God praise for that word on today. And word of consolation and word of revelation. Why we're here today and why we're celebrating this life. The immediate family is going to have final viewing. And then we're going to close and seal and dismiss you all in an orderly fashion. Give us just a few minutes and let's reverence this family and respect them during these final minutes.
your glory. Open our love as we sing, holy, holy, holy. Open the eyes. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Come on and say, open the eyes. Open the eyes of my heart. Oh, open the eyes of my heart, Lord. I want to see you. I want to see you, to see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory, power and love as we sing, holy, 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 high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, holy, holy.
I'm going to ask some ladies to come and assist us with flowers, and might need a couple men as well. We have some heavy flowers, a couple heavy ones here. I'm going to ask you to come down the center aisle, or whatever aisle you're in, and just come around to the center aisle.
I want to see you high and lifted up, high and lifted up,
shining from the light of your glory, pour out your healing love as we sing, holy, holy, holy.
One more time, high and lifted up.
High and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing it. Holy, holy, holy.
Those gentlemen that be serving as pallbearers, please come. Those gentlemen that are serving as pallbearers, please come. Ministers, please come.
I want to see you.
Paul Bears.
Huh?
We have all of our pallbearers. Please line up in twos. Everyone, please stand. Ministers, please come. Everyone, please gather all your wraps. Make sure you look around to make sure you have everything that you're taking with you. Ministers, please come. You all will follow the ministers.
Oh,